there, I'm Glory Okun. Welcome to today's edition of our Splendor Show. Today, we are bringing to you National Children's Park and Zoo in Abuja. Please just relax and enjoy it.
This is the National Children's Park and Zoo in Abuja, situated in the Asokoro Central Business District area. The park and zoo lies beside with the popular Aso Rock. The rock is a 4 meters monolith and is the most noticeable site in the Abuja city. The zoo was established in 2001 by the past administration for relaxation and education for both children and adults. According to the management, the park has recorded high influx of tourists who came to see and learn about various endangered species available.
Actually, it's been registered in the last for almost 15 years. It was actually opened the 31st September 2001 by the then President, His Excellency Chief Olusegun Obasanjo, with the sole intention of providing the people an avenue for the children to educate themselves on the different animals and plants we have in this country, and likewise from other parts of Africa, and also to provide recreation for the adults, that the children can come and recreate themselves, both active and passive, and as well to provide a research and learning, you know, learning place for higher institutions and even primary schools and other schools. These are some of the, you know, objectives to which this place is established. And also, sorry, conservation, to conserve and breed some endangered and threatened wildlife species found in this part of the world.
The green areas are abound with productive exotic economic trees, and flowers planted within the zoo are carefully nurtured and well tended for visitors' delight, are found in various locations in and around the park. There are various types of wild and domestic animals here with their different looks, behaviors, and mannerism. The tour guide who took us around to the environment explained to us the lifestyle of each of the animals.
We have different collection of animals from different species, and we have about 4 to 5 different enclosures. That is a cage where we keep the animals. We have the safari, which is one of the largest enclosures in the zoo, which we have so many types of antelopes from so many species. And we have the camels, that is the domestic enclosure. We have the buffalo. We have the waterfowl, and we have the primates. That is where we keep the baboons and the monkeys. So in the safari enclosure, we have like the ostriches, we have the wildebeest, we have impala, we have gazelles and Grimm's duiker. And we have the buffaloes as well, and the donkey in a buffalo enclosure. We have the impalas too. The impalas is only the male that is having horns. The female don't have horns. And the impalas, their eyes are not keen. They don't see much on the daytime. But they have a very, very good sense of hearing, which enables them to detect the approach of an enemy from far distance. And they equally give birth, just like the wildebeest too, during the rainy season, in order to protect the younger ones as well.
Another interesting sight at the zoo is the crocodile's cage.
It is in the waterfowl enclosure. We have the crocodiles too as well, and the tortoise. So the crocodiles are one of the most dangerous reptiles in the world. The crocodiles, they are reptiles family. In the reptiles family, we have different types of reptiles family. But here we only have about 4 or 5 collections of the reptiles. But we have many of them. We have the crocodiles, we have the snakes, we have the monitor lizard, we have the tortoise. Let's say 4 collections, and turtle as well, that is 5. So all they are reptile species. But the crocodiles lives in the water, mostly live in the water and land side, because mostly they laid eggs. All reptiles animals laid their eggs inside a hole. So you can see the provision of our own crocodiles here. We have a water side and we have a sand. Whereas if it is time for them to lay eggs, they can come out from the water and dig a sand. Then they can lay their eggs or drop their egg inside, and they can lay as many to 90 eggs. And mostly they lay their eggs this period, that's around February, March, approaching the heat period. When they lay the eggs, they cover it in the sand. The temperature from the ground now touches the eggs. They don't lie down on their eggs. And the crocodiles don't have a tongue. They only have a teeth and a tail that usually attack it. The crocodile's mouth is very, very odd. Sometimes if you can observe, you see crocodiles open its mouth and it can stay for like 15 to 20 minutes without even moving. So when they open their mouth, it is a tactical movement for them. When they open their mouth, they collect a lot of flies and insects. You know, flies like other things. So it attracts the flies. When they come to the mouth, they will gum inside the mouth. Then the crocodiles will now close its mouth and go back to the river. If he enters the river, he will open the mouth for the flies, for the fishes inside the river to come for the flies in the crocodile's mouth. Then the crocodile will now go on the fish. So that is their tactical movement on how to hunt. But here they are under captive. We provide all their food, all their needs. And this very one we have, they are about 9 years old. So when they are 7 to 8 years, that is when they started laying their eggs. And they can live up to 65 years under captivity. But in the wild, they can die easily maybe 25, 30 years because of the prey and the other dangers. And the tortoise in the waterfowl, that is the reptile cages. The tortoise are also reptiles. We have 2 different types of tortoise. We have the one that lives in the water, which is called turtle, and the one that lives in the land, which is called land tortoise or giant tortoise. The one that lives on the land have a longer lifespan in the world. In fact, they are the most highest longer lifespan animal in the world. That is the tortoise. Because the very one we have here is about 88 years old, and they can live up to 150 to 200 years if the condition is favorable for them. The tortoise feed on vegetables. They are vegetarians, so even in humans, when you are eating vegetables, you live longer and healthier. So the crocodiles feed, but the one lives in the water.
Tortoise.
The tortoise. That is, they feed the one that lives on the land. That is the one that feeds on vegetables. But the one lives in the water, which is called turtle, feeds on fish. And those ones, they don't have long lifespan, like the one that lives on the land. And if you take that, the one that lives on the land and put it in the water, it will die completely. It cannot survive. And the one that lives in the water, take it out, it can also not survive. We have the ostriches, all in the safari enclosure. The ostriches are the biggest bird in the world, and they are the fastest two-legged animals. The ostrich can run up to 65 to 70 kilometers per hour in a short distance. And we have 2 different colors. We have the black ones, which are the males, and the gray ones, or brown, they are the females. And the ostriches lay eggs once in a year, that is around November, December, probably January. And a single female ostrich can lay about 25 to 30 eggs, or 20 to 25, it depends on the food they eat. You know, sometimes if you give them grommash, they can lay more than that eggs. But averagely, they lay about 25 to 30 eggs in a year. Those period I told you. And a single ostrich can lay about 25, like I told you, and it took them about 45 days to hatch their eggs, unlike ordinary fowl, which hatches their egg in 21, maybe 22 days. Because ostriches are the biggest one. They have wings, but they cannot fly because they are very strong and very, very heavy. So they cannot fly. The buffaloes are one of the most dangerous animals in the world. but they had attack. They attack with their horns and they can destroy so many things with their horns. And the buffaloes, we call them the bush cows because they look like a cow, but they are not cows. But when you look at them from far distance, they look like a cow. But when you come closer, it looks differently and they are very, very aggressive. The buffaloes here, before we fed them, we have to make sure we lock them into the container because they have a very, very good sense of smelling. When we are coming with the food, they move into the container. We now lock them, or the responsible keeper there handling the buffaloes will now lock it down before you make your cleaning and put their food. And the buffaloes also give birth once in a year, 10 to 11 months, and one child at a time.
The zoo also has a natural lake that contains marine life and lakeside bar for guests' relaxation. A large playground equipped with modern facilities for comfort of the visitors.
I've come to Nigeria for the first world after a long, long time away. So I'm looking for something to entice my children to actually come to Nigeria rather than all the ghetto places they show us in the UK. So if my children say that there are more things to see in Nigeria, they will be happy to come. I'm very impressed because some animals I do not expect to see here. I thought they would only have like animals you can see in Nigeria, but I've seen animals that I've not seen before here. Like the first one we saw, the African wild boar. That animal with the big horn, and it's very, very interesting. So, yeah, if they do eventually come, I would like to bring them to come and see that there are more things to see in Nigeria, you know, like they were enjoying in, well, should I say back home? Yeah.
The serene environment of the National Children's Park and Zoo has become the most popular among residents in Abuja and its environs for picnics, meetings, and excursions.
Honestly, they have learned a lot. They have been told about these animals, their life story, how their productivity, how they produce, and their longevity, that's lifespan. They've been told about the lifespan, even though they've been seeing some of them in pictures, they've been able to see them practically, physically, even touch some, and even climb the tortoise. The tortoise was said to have been 88 years old, which is older than myself. That is very interesting, and we are happy to be there.
Even as visitors throng the park on daily basis to explore some of the wonderful spots, the management there said they are facing with challenges. The treatment of the animals in the zoo is managed by veterinary doctors and professional zoologists.
This week, we had a chat with the managing director of Allstate Travel and Tours on his activities in travel business. Listen to him.
We are into tour packaging. We organize tour packages to different parts of Nigeria, and at the same time, you know, run a resort at the Zumarok Nigerian village, which is along the Suleja Kaduna Road. Well, as a tour operator, the business in Nigeria has not been quite flourishing because of the challenges that we're having. But that one notwithstanding, we are still doing our best in trying to move people within Nigeria. particularly Nigerians and then visitors that come into Nigeria for conferences. We try to move them to places of interest because Nigeria is a place with abundant human and natural resources, which makes it a very thriving tourism destination. What we have done as tour operators is we try to put some packages together in terms of leaflets and brochures, which we travel to international tourism exhibitions like the WTM in London and the Indaba in South Africa. All this we do in, you know, to make contact with other tour operators in all those countries so that we could sell Nigeria as a destination. We try to, you know, give them what we offer and what we have as a country. Well, it can affect because if the cost of tickets are high, it means people cannot really afford to travel. But on the other hand, if you look at it, when the value of dollar is quite high, it means the naira, the purchasing power of the naira will be low. So if visitors come into Nigeria with dollar, it means they can afford more facilities. Because if you come with dollar and exchange it in Nigeria, it means you will have more naira to spend, which means for us, on the other hand, it could be, you know, of an added advantage because visitors coming into Nigeria with dollar would be a great advantage to the Nigerian economy because if they come in with the dollar, they will change it into naira and they will get into better hotels, which is quite cheaper for them. They will be able to move to different parts of Nigeria and enjoy what Nigeria offers as a destination. Well, it's very important for government to pay attention to tourism because the government is supposed to be the provider of the enabling environment for tourism to thrive. That means government have to provide security, government has to provide infrastructure, government have to provide avenues for private sectors that are investing in tourism to be able to access funds so that they can, you know, contribute to the development of tourism resorts and tourism facilities. Therefore, government's role is quite important because without security, without good infrastructure, that is good electricity, we cannot be able to have a flourishing tourism industry. Well, for me as an individual, I relax by playing, going sometimes to go and play golf, sometimes take some exercises within my estate, and that is it.
On our program is the first official assignment of the NYSC Director General, Brigadier General Johnson Olawumi, to NYSC National Orientation Camp in Minna, Niger State.
Niger State's NYSC Orientation Camp at PICO was the first camp visited by the NYSC Director General, Brigadier General Johnson Olawumi, after his assumption of office. He arrived at about 10 a.m. in the morning with his entourage, and he was received by senior members of the NYSC staff in the state. This was the mood the corps members welcomed him. The NYSC Director General, led by the State Coordinator, began his assignment with an inspection of the orientation camp. He took out time to go around the camp to see things for himself. Some of the facilities he inspected included kitchen, generators, and stores. The NYSC Director General told journalists that the move was part of his familiarization tour to all the NYSC camps nationwide.
Some of the changes we are likely to see are going to be based on issues that affect core members' welfare, their security, their safety and security, as well as looking at staff welfare. More importantly, looking at how to increase the impact and relevance of the scheme to Nigerians, so that those who are yet to serve will look forward to a period of national service.
At the meeting with the staff, the state coordinator described members of the staff as hard-working staff and commended Niger State Government for creating conducive environment for the scheme in the state.
You have visited our states. We have gone around with you. You have seen that in this secretariat, we have a very good working relationship with the government of Niger States. They have been of great assistance to us. Without the cooperation that we are receiving from the government, I don't know how we will be able to execute our programs in the states. So, sir, I want to tell you that we have a very good, robust working relationship with the government of Niger States. And they have been assisting us in various ways. We went to the camp, you saw what they have done in the camp.
The Director General appealed to them to give him the same support they gave to his predecessor, while promising to build on what he has seen on ground. Another place visited was the garment factory, where he also inspected items produced by core members as well as the facilities there. The Director General expressed concern over the incomplete building he made at the camp and promised to ensure that it is completed. He was also at the core members' lodge to meet with them. The core members used the opportunity to point out some of the challenges they were facing.
The major challenges we have here is the issue of light, issue of water.
Water?
Yes, ma'am. Most especially water. We don't have water here.
We don't have water, how?
The water we normally have here is water bottle. And water bottle comes once in a week. And at times, once in a week, it's just like so an hour or 30 minutes. And when we all rush and get the water that time, anybody that can have the water that time, that's the other thing. Then, what the light issue. Transformer, this transformer we are using, and the transformer we use the whole of this neighborhood, and it's overloaded.
He, however, advised them to be more serious with their newly acquired skills, explaining that it will help them to be self-employed and employers of labor after service year. The NYC boss did not leave without visiting the emir of Mina, Alhaji Farouk Bahago. He told the emir that the visit was to accord respect to the traditional leaders and to receive blessing from him, which he believed will help him to carry out his mandate successfully. The royal father offered prayer of thanksgiving to the Almighty God and congratulated him for his new achievement.
That's all we have for you for this edition of our Splendor Show. Thanks for staying with us. I'm Glory Okon. God bless you. Bye for now.